Early in the morning on November 14th, 1963, sailors on a fishing boat off Iceland's southern coast were enjoying a cup of hot coffee when they caught a whiff of something weird. Sulfur. They couldn't figure out where the smell was coming from. The cook wasn't making eggs, the ship's motor wasn't malfunctioning, and Magnus hadn't eaten beans that night. It wasn't until dawn broke when they saw the source of the smell. Off in the distance, an ominous column of smoke billowed from the sea's surface. Turns out, it wasn't really smoke, but a volcanic plume of ash and gas, including sulfur, that emanated from a volcano erupting on the seafloor. It took less than a day for the puffs of sulfurous smoke to rapidly grow 10 meters above the water, creating the brand new island that the Iceland Naming Committee called Surtsey. While it didn't look like much then, that island has turned out to be a godsend for scientists. It's given them a rare opportunity to study everything from how ecosystems evolve on new land to the origins of life. And they're still learning new things about it today. For starters, a volcanic eruption off the coast of Iceland isn't exactly shocking because the whole country sits along a feature called the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. This is where tectonic plates pull apart from one another, causing hot rocks to rush upward and sparking volcanic eruptions. When hot lava meets water, the results are explosive. Water flashes to steam and blasts apart the volcanic rock, and the eruption itself flings out material called tephra. The smallest bits of tephra are volcanic ash, and the largest chunks are called volcanic blocks or bombs. When Iceland's submarine volcano erupted, tephra and lava rock quickly piled up on the seafloor about 130 meters below the surface. The debris built up rapidly and created the island Surtsey. And this type of explosive volcanic eruption under shallow water is called a Surtseyan eruption after, well, Surtsey. This geological infant grew to a stunning 174 meters above sea level in just 3 months. Like moths to a flame, scientists flocked to Surtsey to study this new land for a very specific reason. Lava is so hot that when it first cools to stone, it's sterile. So islands like Surtsey are a rare chance to understand how waves of critters inhabit new land and how ecosystems evolve in harsh, remote areas. This made Surtsey a kind of giant terrarium for watching an ecosystem develop in real time. And it all starts with the first arrivals, called pioneer species. For lava flows on land, the first living things to appear are often lichens and mosses, which can attach to bare rock and don't need soil to thrive. But Surtsey dared to be different. Instead of the flat, sometimes frilly lichens, one of the island's earliest pioneers was a flowering plant called a sea rocket. It washed onto the shores in the spring after the island's birth, before the volcano had even stopped erupting. Well, slightly late to the party, mosses and lichens took hold a few years later, their spores likely lofted by winds to the island. They mostly grew on steep lava rocks where steam from the crater was keeping the walls moist. One reason mosses and lichens were such late pioneers was because shifting beaches of volcanic tephra made up much of the island, and many areas that were solid rock still rapidly changed as waves battered the freshly cooled lava. While beachfront property is scenic, it's tough to build a home on a crumbling foundation. In fact, some parts of Surtsey weren't stable enough for lichens to colonize until decades later. Winds also carried larger life, like grasses and small willows. But despite these leafy pioneers, Surtsey remained largely animal-free until the first arrivals came down from the skies. Birds. Gulls established colonies in 1985, which rapidly transformed the landscape. They brought seeds and vegetation from nearby islands, and most importantly, they did what birds do best. They pooped everywhere. Their droppings fertilized the land, helping create nutrient-rich soil in which other plants could take root. The earliest avian residents relied on the sea for food, and their activity on the island, from eating to pooping, and everything else, all helped the development of soils on the island. That's harder than it sounds because soil is kind of a living thing, chock full of microorganisms of all kingdoms. Soil allowed insect life to settle in, and from there, ecosystem evolution was off to the races. All that makes it sound like Surtsey is a great place to take a nature-focused vacation? Sadly, that's not in the cards for the vast majority of people, as Surtsey was declared a nature reserve in 1965, prohibiting tourist traffic in order to preserve this ecosystem. Scientists have done all they could to protect the land from human invaders, but they've had a few unintentional impacts. In the summer of 1969, scientists stumbled across a surprisingly familiar plant, one you might even have in your backyard. A tomato. What was this heat-loving crop doing on Surtsey's chilly shores? Specialist August Bjørnesen was called in to find the answer. He cleared the rocks covering the plant's base to reveal what he called a peculiar pile. He poked at it, and then it dawned on him. Some person must have eaten a tomato and then done their business on the island's shores without properly removing the waste, which gave life to this leafy intruder. The scientists swiftly removed the plant, but its appearance was a lesson in how much impact we can have on the land, even when we're not trying to. But before we drop more peculiar piles of information on this island, all science needs funding, and so do we. So here's a quick ad.
Thanks for watching this SciShow video. When you and your friends watch our shows, it helps us continue to make free educational stuff that you love. But that's not the only way to show your support for SciShow. We have a whole merch store, too. At complexly.store, you can get SciShow t-shirts through the end of the year, plus stickers, mugs, and coloring books until we run out. They make great gifts for the lifelong learner on your list. Just be sure to order your t-shirts before November 21st if you're outside the U.S., and before December 8th within the U.S. if you want to gift them for Christmas. Thanks for your support. We couldn't do all this without you.
Apart from learning the importance of proper waste management, the island of Surtsey also gave scientists a model for understanding the origins of life itself. The earliest glimmers of life on Earth probably appeared when land around the world looked a lot like Surtsey, burbling volcanic islands poking up as isolated land masses in a vast ocean that blanketed the world. By studying the volcanic gases and compounds belched up during the eruption, researchers gathered clues about the possible ingredients of our planet's primordial soup. The eruption also hinted at what energy source drove those first sparks of life. Volcanic lightning, which dramatically filled the skies during Surtsey's eruption. Lightning drives chemical reactions, perhaps concentrating important compounds, including the raw materials for life. While studying Surtsey's early chemistry, scientists were excited to find traces of amino acids, the building blocks of protein, which are the basis for life. But there's no way to tell whether the amino acids were formed abiotically, or without help from microbes, as would have been the case on infant Earth. There's still a lot to learn from Surtsey, which is why scientists return to the island each year to continue studying the evolution of life there. But Surtsey's time is running out. While scientists estimate it'll remain above the sea surface for centuries, the island is now shrinking. However, it's only a matter of time before Earth belches up another island, and another remarkable opportunity for scientists to study the development of life in action. But hopefully next time, the researchers won't poop out any plant seeds when they get there.